Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Dr. Shailendra Lalwani, and I am the head of the Department of Liver Transplant and Respiratory Surgery in Manipal Hospital, Delhi. Liver is the largest organ of the body, and it's situated in the right upper quadrant of the abdomen, just behind the ribs. Its weight is 1.2 to 1.5 kg, and it performs more than 500 different liver functions in the body. It has a natural regeneration capacity due to hepatocyte functions, and due to repeated exposure to toxins, it can cause liver damage, and it can lead to chronic liver failure. End-stage liver disease is defined when patients have abnormal liver function who develop decompensation or complications. In end-stage liver disease, scar tissue is regularly replaced the normal liver until unless they have regenerative capacity. And end-stage liver disease is considered to be synonymous with chronic liver failure sometime. End-stage liver disease is the 12th leading cause of death for adults in the US. And in 2004, around 27,000 deaths were reported in the US, which were actually 1.1% of the total deaths. In India, we need 27,000 transplants per year for end-stage liver disease. But currently, we are only doing 1,400 transplants in a year in the whole country. If you see causes of liver cirrhosis globally, there is a lot of difference between Eastern and Western countries. If you see in Eastern countries, the leading cause is hepatitis B virus-related chronic liver disease. And in Western countries, it is hepatitis C virus-related chronic liver disease. But in last 10 years, there has been change in the etiology of this chronic liver failure in India. Right now, if you see, alcoholic liver disease is the most common cause, but non-alcoholic fatty liver disease is coming as epidemic for the chronic liver disease. And in Western countries also, because of obesity, NAFLD is actually on rising trends. Viral hepatitis can be caused by different type of viruses from A, B, C, D, E. A and E usually causes acute liver failure. B, C normally causes chronic liver dysfunction. The route of transmission for A and E is picoral route, and for route for transmission for B and C is normally submucosal or percutaneous route. Hepatitis B and C can be treated, and the treatment is very effective and cure is possible if detected on time. Alcohol is again the leading cause of chronic liver disease nowadays. Alcohol abuses are very common under in the low socioeconomic and high socioeconomic status. Quantity, quality sometimes differs. Alcohol can affect liver in various ways. It can cause steatosis, it can cause repeated hepatitis, and with repeated episode of hepatitis, it can go to cirrhosis. These steatosis and hepatitis stages are reversible if alcohol is stopped on time. Obesity again can cause chronic liver disease in long term. If you see in obese patients, around 5 to 8% patients will have ultimately cirrhosis. Early symptoms are jaundice, anorexia, fatigue, and vomitings. Late symptoms are ascites when there is fluid in the tummy. It can give rise to bloody vomiting, it can give rise to edema, or there is unconsciousness or forgetfulness. These are the late symptoms. When cirrhosis is associated with decompensation, patients can have intractable ascites like water in tummy, and this water can get infected, which is called as spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. Patient can have chronic hepatic encephalopathy. Patient can have recurrent GI bleed, means bleed, blood and vomiting, or in the stool. They can have chronic hepatorenal syndrome or hepatopulmonary syndrome, in which because of liver disease, kidneys or lungs are affected. So what is the prognosis in patients who develop decompensation? If any decompensated patients have symptoms like jaundice, encephalopathy, ascites or variceal hemorrhage, their average lifespan is 2 years. So if you can calculate that if some patient is having ascites in his tummy, the out of 100 patients, only 50% patient will survive after 1 year. If they have hepatopulmonary syndrome, their average survival is 10 months. If they have spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, their average survival is 9 months. If they have hepatorenal syndrome, depending on types of hepatorenal syndrome, their survival average is 6 weeks to 6 months. So to know the prediction of mortality in these patients, there are two scores which is commonly used. One is Child-Pugh score. Second is model for end-stage liver disease. In living donor liver transplant, we mostly use this Child-Pugh scoring system, which depends on the five parameters: encephalopathy, ascites, albumin, bilirubin, and INR. If patient is having a score of more than 10, that is the indication for liver transplantation, and these patients should be referred to transplant center for transplantation. Another score is MELD, which includes three parameters only, that is serum bilirubin, INR, and serum creatinine. And the score of 14 or more, they are being referred to transplant centers for transplants. And in Western countries, this is the criteria they use for deceased donor liver transplant listing. So coming to liver transplant, first transplant was performed by Sir Thomas Sturgill in US in 1963. First successful full transplant was done by the same fellow in 1967. But it was in 1980 when cyclosporine was discovered and result of transplant started improving. And in 1980 again, the development of University of Wisconsin solution, which is used for graft preservation. These were the two landmark research which actually gave the boost to the liver transplant. After 1980, if you see, survival was better than 1970s. So in early 1980s, the liver transplant became the clinical reality. In 1983, it became the definitive therapy for end-stage liver disease. So liver transplantation is a life-saving procedure for end-stage liver disease. Liver failure can be of acute or chronic. Currently, 1 year patient survival is around 85 to 90%, and 5 year survival rate is around 75%. These are the famous personalities like Steve Jobs. He developed pancreatic cancer and he underwent Whipple's procedure for that. But later on, he developed neuroendocrinal secondaries in the liver. So he underwent liver transplantation for neuroendocrinal secondaries. But later on, he died after transplant. Second one is Barcelona defender Eric, who underwent liver dissection in 2011 for liver cancer. But in 2012, he again developed recurrence then he underwent liver transplantation in 2012. So in last 40 years, if you see, liver transplantation has evolved from an experimental procedure to the definitive treatment option for patients with acute and chronic liver disease. This is the survival rate. If you see, 10-year survival is around 60 to 80%, in between 60 to 80%. If you see, living donor liver transplant survival is better than deceased donor liver transplant. You can see the blue brick. In India, the transplant numbers are gradually increasing. You can see in 2014, numbers were highest, that was around 1400, and from 2014 to 2020 there has been no major increase in the, because every center has the capacity of doing limited liver transplants only. So right now, if you see, in 2019 in India, it was around 1450 transplants were done. So when patient should be referred to transplant center? The patients who are too well should not be transplanted. Likewise, if patient is too sick, he also should not be transplanted, because these patients will have poor outcome. Thus, liver transplantation should be performed when the patient's survival chances are highest. Source of graft can be deceased donor liver transplant or living donor liver transplant. In deceased donor transplant, two type of donors are available. One is brain dead and after brain dead, one is after cardiac death. But results of donation after cardiac death, if you do transplants, are inferior. Living donor transplant advantages, you will have that you can choose the donor with better graft. Transplants, living donor liver transplants, we take different type of lobes, right lobe, left lateral segment, and posterior sectoral graft, depending on the liver volume and the weight of the recipient. In deceased donor, we normally remove the whole liver of the recipient patient, and we implant the complete liver from the brain dead donor in the recipient. In living donor liver transplant, we usually take half or 60% of the liver, depending on the age and weight of the recipient. And we implant this half of the liver after the explantation of the complete liver from the recipient. These are few indications when patients having cirrhosis and he developed some complication in the form of hepatic encephalopathy, increasing ascites, recurrent variceal bleed, spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, or he is having some side effects of liver disease like hepatopulmonary syndrome, hepatorenal syndrome, development of liver cancer in cirrhotic liver, which is very common. If he develop muscle wasting or he will have increased osteopenia, these are the indications for liver transplant in chronic liver disease. These are few more indications in which patient will have metabolic liver disease, and liver transplant is the only treatment in patients with like Wilson disease, glycogenic storage disease, urea cycle disorder, citrullinemia type, and few other indications are polycystic liver disease and Budd-Chiari syndrome. Budd-Chiari syndrome is very common in the Gulf countries. These are few absolute or relative contraindications. Absolute contraindications are extrahepatic malignancy, active alcoholism, active substance abuse, and non-compliance. Relative contraindications are portopulmonary hypertension. Large HCC and HIV is no more a contraindication nowadays, because initially we used to have Milan's criteria for transplantation in hepatocellular carcinoma. But that criteria has been changed by different centers, and now there is no size limit actually for transplantation in hepatocellular carcinoma. And we are doing regularly transplants in HIV patients also. We ourselves have some experience of doing transplants in HIV patients if the disease is not that worse. Fulminant hepatic failure is one of the another cause which give very good results with liver transplant. And fulminant hepatic failure is called as when basically patient develop encephalopathy, jaundice, and coagulopathy when there is no pre-existing chronic liver disease. Once these patients will have meet the King's College criteria, they should undergo liver transplant, and mortality is 90% without transplant in these patients. And success of transplant in these patients is around 85% to 90%. Mortality causes are mainly liver failure, sepsis, and multi-organ failure in these acute hepatic failure. So in LDLT, we have some advantages, like you can take ideal donor, you can see the graft quality, there is time to prepare the recipient, so he can be optimized. You can schedule the case electively. So if you want to get it done earliest, you can get it early. If you can wait for some time, you can wait for some time also. And there is relative short cold ischemia time, because you can actually plan these surgeries, donor and recipient. So how we select the donor? Donor ideally should be between 18 to 55 years of age. They should be related voluntary donor. There should be no major comorbidity. If they are smokers or taking contraceptive pills, they should be abstinent for 6 weeks prior to surgery. In Indian patients, we take cutoff BMI of less than 27, but we take 30 cutoff BMI for Middle East patient when they have remnant of 30% or above. Liver attenuation index of more than 5 is acceptable. Less than that, we have to do liver biopsy, and depending on the liver biopsy result, we accept or reject these donors. There should be compatible blood group matching definitely. If donor is O, then he can donate to recipient of blood group O, A, B, or AB. Means he is the universal donor. If donor's blood group is A, he can donate to A or AB. If donor's blood group is B, he can donate to B or AB. If donor's blood group is AB, he can only donate to AB blood group recipient. Donor should be providing a graft of adequate size, which is usually determined on the CT volumetry, and donor should undergo a thorough medical and psychological evaluation. If he is psychologically and medically fit, then only he can give or donate his liver. He should understand the risk of surgery fully. If we don't have actually ABO compatible donor, so we can go ahead with ABO incompatible transplant also, but results are a bit inferior as compared to ABO compatible transplant, but still the success rate is reasonably good. If the volume of one donor is not sufficient for recipient, then we can take two different lobes from two donors and that can be implanted in the single recipient. So these are the basically methods by which we can actually transplant a patient who don't have the suitable donor means because of volume or matching blood group. Recent advance, if you see, there is a great advancement in the CT softwares actually. By that, we can actually assess the volume and anatomy of the liver, which actually help us to assess the suitability of the donor in terms of volume as well as anatomy of the donor. You can see how beautiful pictures are these, which can tell you which vein is draining which segment of liver. There can be a lot of anatomical variation of hepatic arteries. Previously, if you see 10 years back, we used to reject few donors because of this arterial anatomical variation. But nowadays, it's very rare that because of this anatomical variation, we are rejecting any donor. Similar things happen with the portal vein. Previously, we used to reject the donor who was having two portal veins. But nowadays, we are accepting two portal veins. We are only rejecting type D anatomy in which actually the opposite segment is supplied by the opposite portal vein. Similarly, anatomical variations are common in biliary tree, but in today's era, there is no contraindication of doing liver transplant because of anatomical variation of the biliary anatomy. Similarly, hepatic veins, previously we used to reject the donors with the multiple hepatic veins. Now we have actually reconstructed the 8 veins also. So it's a very difficult situation, but now it is possible. So this is the one of the basically advancement because of technical advancement, innovation. This you can see the implantation. We have used PTFE grafts. This is the another technology which we have developed in last 5-7 years. We don't use because sometimes veins are not available from the graft. So now we have started using this PTFE graft for venous reconstruction. After the transplant, patient is shifted to ICU and his liver functions are actually being monitored regularly. His fibrinogen level, usually in next 3 days, there is gradual normalization of AST and ALT, bilirubin and prothrombin time. There is early elevation of liver enzymes always, which is followed by quick normalization in 3 to 5 days. These patients will tend to have thrombocytopenia after the transplant, but after 1 week, usually in second week, it started rising. We do normally ultrasound Doppler till 5 days in ICU. Once patient is out of ICU, we stop doing it. We normally start immunosuppression from the day of surgery only. And in next 7 days, we start monitoring these immunosuppression drug levels also. Transplant can have few complications, like early complications are primary graft failure, vascular complications, infections, and acute rejection. But most of these are treatable, except the primary graft failure that needs retransplant. Otherwise, other complications can be managed in most of the cases. Late complications are infection, chronic rejection, biliary complication, post-transplant lymphoproliferative disorders. But if detected on time, most of these can be managed except post-transplant lymphoproliferative disorders. So these are the common questions actually most of the people ask, what is the risk to the liver donor? So right hepatectomy is a complex procedure. Wound pain is quite common, but for that we are actually putting epidural, so that is being taken care of. Psychological trauma is there in case of recipient death. If recipient get discharged, see, donor is always happy and they have less no psychological trauma. If you see, overall risk is around 0.1 to 0.5%. Minor complication risk around 2 to 4%. This is second question, that when can donor resume their work after the surgery? So normally donor is discharged within 7 to 10 days. Donor can resume his normal activity within 3 to 4 weeks and resume his jobs within 6 weeks time. There is no special precaution donor has to take care. after about 4 to 6 weeks, and he can live a normal life thereafter. So most of the complication in donors, if at all happens, is in the early post-operative period, and 99% of these complications are managed by smaller procedures like doing aspirating the fluid or putting the PCD. So what is the actual outcome of success of this transplant procedure? So the survival rate at around 1 year, if you see, is around 89%, and at 5 years, 75 to 80% patients will be alive if you do 100 transplants. These are few technical innovations which we are being doing now regularly. This is dual lobe transplant, in which actually one donor is not sufficient for the recipient because of volume issues. So we take two different lobes from two different donors. So this is the dual lobe transplant. You can see right lobe and left lobe we have implanted in the recipient. This another technical innovation which we have done when we are doing pediatric transplant. If you see this left lobe graft, left lateral lobe graft is actually too huge for a 1 year old or 5-6 months old child. So what we have done, we have reduced that graft, because larger is the graft, if the graft is larger, portal vein flow is not that great, then this graft ultimately will get necrosis. So we have reduced this graft, and this is the final picture after the reduction of the graft, and you can see this much we have reduced while taking the graft from the donor, and this is after implantation, and this is the final picture of the graft in the small kid, which was I think around, it was, he was 5 to 6 month old child only. Recently we have gained the experience in minimally invasive donor surgery. It was started in 2002 actually, but it became reality in 2012 or 13 only. We have started this doing around 3 years back. Initially we were doing laparoscopic assisted donor hepatectomy only, and then we upgraded us to pure laparoscopic left lateral donor hepatectomy for pediatric recipient, and now we are taking doing right donor robotic right donor hepatectomies also. But the problem with robotic donor hepatectomy, it will cost around $4,000 to $5,000 extra to the patient. You can see this donor robotic liver resection is being performed by us. Again, this robotic hepatectomy in non-donor hepatectomy actually. Again, similarly, we are doing the transection by the robotic surgery. This is the use of intraoperative ultrasound to mark the transection line in the donor hepatectomy. We are actually believers in cosmetic donor hepatectomy. You can see the scar is comparatively less if you see the recipient's scar that is used. So previously, people, what they were doing, that they were doing this, giving the same incision as this recipient is having, but now you can see we have reduced the scar size very significantly. This is the Mongolian donor who is a supermodel in her own country, and she donated her right lobe for her mother. But now you can rarely identify the scar if you can see it very, very deeply. He's another donor who became the bodybuilder actually. So you can see the drastic change in his body. This is the experience of our team. We have experience of over a decade. Our team has done around more than 1800 transplants. Out of them, 90% are adult, and we are having reasonably very good experience of a pediatric transplant, that is around 10%. Overall success rate is around 95%, and our survival in emergency transplant for acute liver failure is 92%, and 1 year survival is around 89%. In chronic liver disease, our 1 year survival is 92% and 3 year survival is 88%. We have done 17 combined liver kidney transplants also, and we have done 5 dual lobe transplants. That is the big achievement. I think that is the probably we are the third or fourth center in the world who has done 5 dual lobe liver transplants. Most of the people are not that experts in doing dual lobe transplants. We have done 4 swab series. These are our achievements. If you see pediatric liver transplant, we have done in less than 10 kg weight child. We have done the smallest weighing child transplant also. And we have done liver transplant in a child who was having hemiparesis. It was first in India, this kind of transplants. And that kid is doing well after even 6 years, his hemiparesis has also improved. We have done 5 dual lobe transplant in which we take, as I told you, that we take 2 grafts from 2 different donors and we transplant it in 1 recipient. We have done retransplant also in a child, which is a very difficult thing to perform. We have done living donor liver transplant in a strongly positive cross-match patient, which usually is not being done by other centers, and the success rate in this transplant is very low, but we have done 2 transplants in a strongly positive cross-match patient, and even after 4 or 5 years of transplant, they are doing very well. We have done ABO incompatible transplant. Definitely, as I said, results of ABO incompatible transplant is not as equal as compatible transplant. We have done transplant in HIV positive patients, and I think that was the 2nd in India, which we did, I think, 3-4 years back, and patient is doing well. Transplant, we have done transplant with removal of cardiac tumor simultaneously, which was the first transplant of that kind in the world. So to summarize, liver transplant is a good management option for end-stage liver disease, and complication rates are low, and we have a very good success rate. Risk to donor is minimal. Transplant will improve the quality of life and prolong disease-free survival. And with technical advancement, there are only few contraindications nowadays. Thank you. If there is any question, I'll be happy to answer. I think first question is that does cousin marriages in Gulf countries one of the cause of liver transplant or disease? Yes, but it usually happens in the children's, not in adults, because this consanguineous marriage is actually a cause of many genetic disease. Second question is, what is the prognosis of donor? So as I told you in the presentation, the risk for donor is around 0.1 to 0.5%. So if you see, success rate is 99.5%. This is small risk is always there when you are actually traveling somewhere or you are crossing the road. So it's like that only. I think there is another question, actually, what type of disease you get actually once you marry to a cousins. So these are actually metabolic disorders, which I told you, many Wilson's disease, citrullinemia, like any genetic disorders they can have. There is one more question. I think in case of no related donor is available for a patient, what can be done in these cases? So one option, as I told you, is means ABO incompatibility. They have donor in the family, but blood group is not matching. Second option is if they have no suitable donor, means because of volume issue, if they are having some problem. So we can take 2 grafts, as I told you, and we can do dual lobe transplants. A third option is they don't have any donor in the family. Then actually it's a difficult situation for them. Then they can register for the deceased donor liver transplant at our center. Once the graft is available, but that is available only for Indian patients, not for foreigners, because it's because of basically restrictions in some law. Another option is they can actually, it's up to the committee actually, but they can actually find a donor in nearby relatives or in friends who are actually attached with them for more than 10 years. Then committee can review the case, and if they found that there is no no problem in doing this, then only we can actually do. So it's very difficult situation actually. So first option is they can register for deceased donor liver transplant, and second option is they can actually apply with a unrelated donor, but it should be at least emotionally related. because sometimes what happens if it is emotionally related and they are actually living together or like a relative since many years and they have some evidence for that, the committee consider these type of cases also. But that depends on the committee itself, because once committee will clear, we'll do transplants only after that. So it's not that easy thing actually. So if there is any further question, you can actually contact our marketing team, or you can find my number on the Google search, and you can message me or call me for any query or questions if you are having in your mind. So thank you all for listening, and so we'll finish this session now. Thank you.